Tame, welcome to the first TVNZ FC of the season. Joining us today, Simon Plum and Valdez Waters. Today on the show, we're going to look at a number of Northern transfers over the off-season. We'll cast our eyes over the new Premier League and European campaigns, and we'll have a look at some of the Kiwis who've been catching the football world's attention overseas. Kia ora, guys. Welcome back.
Yeah, it's good to be back.
Had any big transfer news on your fronts? I see that Jack Mabeer's not here. Chris Chang's transferred off to Europe for a couple of weeks.
Exactly.
Harry Maguire. Fascinating, eh? Is he worth £80 million?
He's not even worth a quarter of £80
million.
Look, the guy scored a goal for England against Sweden at the World... Was it Sweden at the World Cup?
Yeah.
You know, and he becomes a bit of a, you know, cult hero. He's OK. But he's not worth 80 million bloody pounds.
Yeah.
You know, but hey, look, go for Man United.
What if Van Dijk went for 75,
yeah.
Right? I mean, and if you were to say Van Dijk or Maguire, who are you going to pick?
You're only taking one, you're taking Van Dijk. Because the like for like, 75 versus 80, you're going to take Van Dijk all day long. But it's almost like a house price. You know, he's caught in a market now where the prices are going up.
Mm.
He's a great player. He's a lot better than Valdez gives him credit for, that's for sure.
I think he's worth more than 20 million.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Look, there's a lot of parallels too with Rio Ferdinand. I think Rio Ferdinand left for Leeds, was it 50 million pounds?
Be about that, yeah.
And so there seems to be a lot of people are saying, well, you know, he might end up being like Rio Ferdinand. Yet to be seen. Look, he's an okay player. I don't think he's worth £80 million. I think maybe he'll start, you know, a bench player.
He likes to play it out from the back a lot. I mean, yeah. I know that's the kind of style of all European football at the moment, but this kind of...
He's the
same old pace. You know, when he turns, he reminds me of me.
He reminds me of Phil Jones, let's be honest. He's the same sort of mould as Phil Jones, Gary Cahill, that sort of...
Do you really think he'll start on the bench?
I really don't think he's going to be starting, no.
He's going to start on the bench for £80
million. You think a world record for...
I don't think he's good enough to be starting. I really don't. But anyway, we'll see.
Interesting.
Okay.
Wayne Rooney.
Mm.
Speaking of United,
yeah. What do you think?
Well, it's a bolt from the blue, that's for sure. He's kind of been doing exhibition stuff in the US at the moment. Mm. But it now looks like he's going to be a player manager for Derby. Obviously, right. Frank Lampard leaving Derby to go to Chelsea, manage them. Bit of a hole there. It's a very odd move. Philippe Cocu is now the former Dutch international, is now the Derby coach.
Mm.
It'd be a good move for Rooney and it'd be a coup for Derby, as much as that pains me to say.
A player coach, I mean, what sort of leadership qualities does Wayne Rooney have? I'm not suggesting he's playing in the Championship. He doesn't have the footballing skills to still hack it, but as a leader, I'm not so sure.
I think that's a fair question. I mean, I always wondered why he was captain of England. He doesn't seem like the kind of guy who you would want to bind your team around.
No.
But in terms of the gravity that he will bring to Derby County, a huge star, and I'm sure that would bind some players.
It seems to be a string of players recently. We saw Vincent Kompany now gone to Anderlecht, same sort of thing, player, coach. Mm. Maybe it's a new thing, these sort of players towards the end of their careers, they want to become managers, but they still want to play, and maybe it's a new avenue for them. Who knows? It could be more.
Eden Hazard's gone from Chelsea, and he's not doing anything for Real Madrid.
No, and he needs to get on a treadmill because he's bloody overweight.
Yeah.
There's some great pictures of him with a few, you know, mutton chops. You know,
you don't want to be body shaming Eden Hazard this morning. But
well, no, he's signing for Real Madrid.
I think we say he's unfit. I think that's
they've got a lot of issues, and one of them is his weight. He looks severely overweight, not good. They've had a few players who have looked a few kilos over.
In the pre-season, no goals, no assists so far.
Their best players have been their goalkeepers, really. So they won, I think, one game on penalties in the pre-season.
Yeah.
They're not looking good.
They're not, and they're coming off a really poor season last season as well. So there's a lot of pressure on him. He's kind of being looked at as the guy to turn Real around on his own. That's quite a big job, frankly, because they're really poor.
Have we seen anything in club competition that matched Eden Hazard's performance in the World Cup? You know, since that World Cup, I think you know, everyone thought this is the moment, this is the guy when he's running at defenders, he has them turning, he has them off balance, all that sort of thing. And I don't know that we ever saw it again in club competition after that World Cup.
Not sustained, I think you're right, Jack. You kind of saw fits and starts of it in the Premier League, but definitely not a sustained period. But you could probably argue that as an elite athlete, they try and peak for the right window, and he probably did that. But
He's never been a player that's going to score you 30-plus goals a season. He's not. He's the guy that will set them up or he'll create enough of a distraction to set up other players. And I don't think he's the answer to Real Madrid's problems. I think they still haven't properly replaced Ronaldo. They don't have anyone scoring the goals that he used to score. And then you've got Gareth Bale, who's more interested in playing golf than supporting his teammates. Well, to be fair, they don't really know what to do with him, really, do they?
It's an odd situation there, for
offloaded
sure.
to China, and then that deal didn't go through. So who knows what's going to happen with him still.
Community Shield, City got up on penalties, knowing he's terribly excited about these things. But do you think that's a gentle foreboding of what is coming this season again? City just pipping Liverpool at the post?
Could well be. I mean, you could probably argue that Liverpool were the better side in that game, even though Sterling missed a couple of gilt-edged chances that City should have buried it really well before full-time and penalties. But they're going to be the top two again this season, absolutely no doubt. They're a different class, for sure.
I think it was a reflection. It's going to be a reflection of this season. I think fine margins again. We saw Kyle Walker's clearance, bicycle kick clearance off the line. Shades of last season in a similar game where they had a goal, you know, kicked off the line. So I think it's going to be a similar sort of scenario. But I do rate a lot of these middle tier clubs in the Premier League. I think the likes of Everton have signed really well in the off-season. And I think they'll be up there. But I think the top two will be City.
I'll get to your predictions for relegations and top four in a moment. But what does Liverpool have to do to get ahead of City this year? See, to me, it feels as though that elusive championship is still missing for Liverpool. They're coming off a Champions League victory, which is fantastic for them. But you still look at that City squad and you think, man, it's going to be super hard for Liverpool to get up.
Totally. It's almost, last season with Liverpool, it's almost they could have done nothing more.
It was their best season.
They finished 97 points.
It was just unbelievable.
It's crazy. The problem with Liverpool is if they get any injuries to key players like Van Dijk, Alisson or any of the front three, they're really struggling to fill those holes. City, on the other hand, can plug them quite easily. You've seen with De Bruyne being out for most of the season. They don't miss him. They can just pop another world-class guy in. Liverpool kind of need to come out firing from the start, and they could do with Salah to be in better form earlier. If he can do that, then they've got a real chance. But fitness and injuries are huge for them this season.
Okay, let's get your top four predictions. So we all agree that City and Liverpool are probably going to be one and two. In whatever order, we're not 100% sure. Who else is going to round out that top four?
I'd probably say Spurs. I think Spurs look quite... I think they'll continue where they left off last season. And Chelsea. Frank Lampard, I think, is going to give them, you know, the boost that they needed that they probably didn't have last season.
What do you think, Simon?
Yeah, I think I'd go with Tottenham as well for third. And I think it's an absolute... you could throw a blanket over the rest for fourth. Yeah. I mean, Chelsea could be a dark horse. They've kind of been written off because they've got Lampard in charge and because they've got a transfer ban.
Yeah.
But they've got...
Arsenal?
Potentially.
Not with that
potentially.
Defense, honestly.
I mean, Arsenal were looking good until April last year. They lost three or four games and that was it.
Arsenal, they've signed Pepe for a huge fee. Yeah.
Great signing.
A brilliant signing. If you see this guy up close, his ball control is different level. It's absolutely sickening. So good. But their problem is not in midfield. Their problem is in defence. If you look at how many goals they conceded last season, they conceded more than Newcastle. But they're scoring as many as kind of Liverpool, Man City. They were just behind them.
Yeah.
So their problem isn't in the middle third. It's at the back. So Arsenal, for me, they've not moved that much further forward. But Chelsea could do all right.
Relegation zone, Newcastle.
Yep. They're top of the list for me. I'd probably say Sheffield United. I think they might struggle. Yeah. I think of the teams that have come up, Norwich and Villa should do okay.
Yeah.
I think Brighton might struggle.
That was the other team for me, Brighton. I think they just scraped home last season. I don't. They haven't really improved their squad this season. I don't see them. But who knows?
All right. Victor, Simon, stick around. We will be back in just a moment. All right, we'll get on to the Kiwi prospects around the world in just a moment, but let's get our predictions for Europe. We're looking at the likes of Barca, PSG, probably lining up another dominant season.
Yeah, I would say so. I think it's going to be business as usual. Real Madrid, I think, in Spain will continue to be poor. I think Atletico have signed very well in the off-season. Kieran Trippier, what a great signing that was, and out of the blue. And I think Simeone...
Juventus
as well, I think, although, you know, we've got to keep an eye on them. They might lose Dybala in the transfer window, who's a very important player for them. But I just... PSG again in France, I think, will dominate again. It just seems business as usual.
Yeah, it does. Yeah, I'd agree. I think in Spain particularly, you could see Atletico puncture that top two for the first time in a long time. I think that would be great to see. I think Barca have had also quite a poor season by their standards.
Yeah.
Real Real still look really wobbly, but Atletico had signed really, really cannily. They could do something.
What about Sarpreet Singh in Bayern Munich?
Yeah,
are we going to see more of him? And first of all, it has just been incredible, hasn't it? To watch him come on and hold his own, albeit in you know, pre-season games, nothing. He's not facing the full pressure that he might expect in a real big clash in the Bundesliga. But he's come on and he's holding his own.
Yeah, and then I think the coaches must be very pleased with him because they wouldn't keep him around for as long as they have. And I think he's going to be staying for another week now with the first team. You know, I think he might get some call-ups maybe for some cup games or something. I think he's obviously really impressed the coaches. He's impressed everyone here. And it's so great to have that as an advertisement for New Zealand football. Yeah. And now kids are going to be like, well, I don't want to be like Ronaldo or Messi. I want to be like Sarpreet Singh here in New Zealand. So it's a really positive thing.
Yeah, it's great. It was almost a bit of a bolt out of the blue that Bayern, a club of that scale, were interested in a guy from the A-League. It's huge.
Yeah. I mean, he deserves it. On that World Cup performance, you would have to say he deserved a big level European signing.
Yeah, and he's gone over there and there's kind of talk that he might get loaned out straight away, which for me never really made sense, because if you're moving from the A-League into the Bundesliga in a club like Bayern, the whole point is to get soaked into that environment and start being around world-class players. But it actually looks over the past couple of days that his squad number has changed. So he originally signed for, I think it was the reserve team.
Yes.
Yeah. But it now looks like his squad number has changed and he could be part of the actual first team squad.
Yeah.
If that's true, that would be colossal
Huge.
For him.
That would be massive. Mm. I don't know, watching him, it's hard to judge, but the physicality of the A-League versus European football, there's obviously a significant difference there. Mm. I feel like he could do with a little bit more size. Yeah. You know, he's a young man still, 20 years old. Yeah. I imagine they're going to be doing a lot of work trying to condition him as much as possible because he's very, very technical. He's got the technical skills, but it's just that size, I think, might be.
You see that with a lot of the younger players who have...
Yeah.
I think it happened with Messi. It's happened with a lot of the younger players who are very small at the beginning. Mm. They get bumped off the ball, but you can tell they have the skill. And then over the years, they get conditioned and they get a bit bigger. Mm-hmm. I think, you know, it's just a matter of time. The German league is quite physical. It's sort of similar to probably the Premier League. But he's a technical player. He's good enough. I'm sure he'll hold his own.
Yeah, Winston Reid's back after a long, long, long absence. He's 31 now. Yeah. I mean, the knee looks all right in pre-season stuff, but do you think he's likely to stick around for the season or is he going to be traded?
Well, the thing is, he never really got a chance last season. I don't think Pellegrini really got a good look at him. I don't think he'll be sold. I think he'll stay. He's a captain, of course, after all. So. Mm. Give him a chance, please, Pellegrini. You know, come on.
Yeah, I think he's at a bit of a crossroads in his career, to be quite honest. As you mentioned, Jack, he's 31. He's been out for a year and a half. Yeah. Mm. He's at a club where they're probably looking to strengthen at centre-back. There is some talk that either Reid or another one of their centre-backs might go because Declan Rice can also cover there. Yeah. The problem is, he's not a particularly attractive prospect. He's highly injury-prone. Mm. He's quite old and he'll be on fat wages at the moment. Mm. So... I can see him not going anywhere, but not really playing either. Mm. It's a bit of an issue, to be honest.
Chris Wood scoring goals.
Yeah, he looks brilliant. Mm. Yeah,
it's really good.
I think it's 9 in pre-season, including a hat-trick against Nice. Good on him. He's really had... They had a bit of a tricky season last season,
apparently. Yeah,
but he's looking really good. He's definitely the kind of talisman for New Zealand football at the moment.
Mm. And in the US, in the National Women's Soccer League, Rosie White scoring for Rain FC... against Houston, another solid performance. She's been performing pretty well for them. Ended up man of the match the other day. Woman of the match.
Woman of the
match. Yeah. She'll be pleased with that because they had a pretty poor World Cup. Yeah. She won't be happy with that. But I think to get back playing and get scoring goals, she'll be really pleased. That's good for her confidence.
Yeah, are you guys setting all your alarms and all that sort of stuff now? You're sorted. You're back into that. You know, you're out of the hibernation mode.
Fantasy football. You know, studying. You know, seeing all the new signings. Who's going to fit where? So that's been another big part in the newsroom.
Yeah. I was about 4:30 last weekend to watch my side lose, which was great.
Only 9 more months of that, Simon.
That's brilliant.
Hey, fantastic. Thank you so much for your time. Victor Valdez, Waters and Simon Plum. That is us for today. We will be back next week. And don't forget, TVNZ FC is available on One News Now, Facebook, YouTube, and as a podcast in all the usual places. Hey, Cornada.